conference, the GS is here with me as usual. He'll be reading a statement after which we'll be taking questions as usual. GS?
Good morning. Once again, the statement reads as follows. The People's Progressive Party wishes to refer to a statement made by Mr. David Granger in late October 2015 when he declared, quote, "No new crime wave has hit the country, but rather there is a continuation of what started following the 2002 jailbreak." Mr. Granger went on to add, quote, "I don't think we are in the grip of another crime wave," end of quote. The PPP disagrees and wishes to refer to the following headlines which appeared in the daily newspapers over the past 2 to 3 weeks. Quote unquote, "Crabwood Creek smuggler shot dead." Quote unquote, "Escribo agent attached to Bihari and Company Limited robbed." Quote unquote, "Elderly man battered to death at Linden." Quote unquote, "Party going passengers rob driver hijacks car." Next, "Businesswoman fights off gunmen to save car." Next, "Gunmen rob electronic store, terrorize staff." Next, "Bandits put shears to victim's neck, terrorize household." Followed by, "Good Hope farmer attacked while in bed." Then, "Pensioners beaten, robbed." Followed by, "Venezuelan woman robbed at gunpoint." And then, "Gang of Five beat and robbed quarantine couple." These recent criminal occurrences expose the logical fallacy behind Granger's claim that, quote, "the country is not experiencing a new crime wave," end of quote. Mr. Granger's explanation is pure, unadulterated semantics. It is disingenuous and must be exposed as an attempt to evade the issue. Mr. Granger appears to be laboring under the illusion that there is a difference between what is a crime wave and what is a high level of crime. He seems to be holding to the view that the only crime wave Guyana experienced was as a result of the 2002 jailbreak, and that since then there has been no new crime wave affecting Guyana. From Mr. Granger's information and guidance, there is a popular perception that there is a crime wave in our country. That perception, if not reality, is based on reports that there is a sustained increase in the number of crimes committed in the country. The question, therefore, either by definition or perception, is whether Guyana is currently experiencing an increase in the number of crimes committed. The answer is to be found in the statistics on serious crimes published from time to time by the Guyana Police Force. Moreover, early this year, the U.S. State Department issued an advisory stating, quote, "Criminal activity continues to be a major threat, particularly violent aggravated robberies," end of quote. Therefore, no amount of semantics nor excuses from any quarter can contradict the fact that there has been and still is an increase, if not heightened, criminal activities in Guyana. The Granger-led coalition administration would very much like to wish this unpleasant situation away by claiming that, quote, "criminals are being caught," end of quote, that, quote, "measures are starting to work," end of quote, that, quote, "gangs are being dismantled," end of quote, and that, quote, "the crime situation is under control." Contrary to these claims, over the past few days, we witnessed several serious crimes being reported, For example, Kitty businessman shot and robbed. Elderly Kanji, East Kanji man hospitalized after early morning bandit attack. Gunmen hit Good Fortune shop. And Elizabeth Harper's daughter beaten and robbed. What does all this mean to the general public? The APNU and AFC promise in their manifesto to bring about, quote, sustained improvement in crime prevention and the security environment, end of quote, as well as a good life for all Guyanese. Where is all this right now in the face of the ongoing crime wave in the country? In this regard, the Granger administration has failed miserably. Compounding the situation even more is the slew of non-reported crimes, which appears to be mounting as a result of the lack of public confidence in the law enforcement agencies, especially the Guyana Police Force. We have heard nothing of the much-touted anti-crime plan that was submitted months ago by the Commission of Police to the Public Security Minister, who in turn claimed he submitted the same to Cabinet. In the meanwhile, former Chief of Staff of the Guyana Defense Force, Edward Collins, appears to be off on a frolic of his own, formulating a parallel plan commissioned by Office of the President. Confusion, as usual, reigns. This sorry state of affairs will get worse with the economic situation in the country spiraling downwards. This situation will only serve to exacerbate the causes of crime, which Mr. Granger admits has to be looked at and to bring about uncertain changes in our society. The APNU AFC will end up like a dog chasing its tail. The PVP wishes to remind that while in opposition, Mr. Granger and his acolytes had enough time to look at the causes of crime. Further, they had claimed that they had all the solutions to bring about the so-called certain changes in our society. Now that Mr. Granger and his cohort are in the driving seat and have the opportunity to apply all their grandiose ideas and clever sounding solutions, they have been proven incompetent and helpless in providing the good life to all Guyanese. In fact, they have been doing so only for a small urban middle class bureaucratic elite who were catapulted into power by GCOM. To rely on the British-sponsored Security Sector Reform Action Plan as the solution is to seek refuge in a fool's paradise. Only time and experience will tell. In this respect, the PVP will have much more to say on this matter in time to come, save and except to point out that as far as Mr. Granger's conclusion on the crime situation is concerned, it is fundamentally flawed and founded on a fallacy based more on fiction rather than fact that cannot be proven in the same way as his conclusions itself. Thank you.
Okay, there are the statements. In the statement, now questions. Adam?
Yes, sir. The situation of crime, sir, do you believe that there's a correlation between the academic level of the young people and the crime situation at this time? And if that is so, would you therefore admit that the academic level declined over the past 23 years and what we are seeing today is the result of that decline in academic level?
Well, that is precisely what I said in my statement, although in a different way, where Mr. Granger and his people claim that that is a situation that has to be looked at. All the years in the opposition, they had all the time to look at that. They're still looking at it. Then he also claimed that the causes of crime can only change if certain things in the society change as well. Well, he's in the driving seat now to improve the academic level of the young people and to bring about these certain changes, which he said are fundamental if the crime situation is to change.
And sir, how can you suggest that gangs aren't being dismantled and that more crimes are being solved today, when the same headlines, some of which you quoted, would suggest that this is happening? There are fewer robberies coming from people coming from the airport. There are fewer home invasions. There are fewer robberies of people leaving the commercial banks with money. Would you not say that the situation is changing slowly?
Why would I say that if the situation, if the facts show something different? There has been a marked increase in the number of robberies from 2013 to 2014, armed robberies. No, I'm saying there has been a marked increase in armed robberies.
Mm-hmm.
There has been, then when you compare the increase in gun-related crimes from the time when the APNU AFC came into office, to know, compared to the corresponding period to last year. Obviously, the police statistics show that there has been an increase as well. So, I would not argue that the situation has improved. In fact, Mr. Granger himself has admitted at several places that the crime situation has not improved. And he is banking on the British-sponsored Security Reform Action Plan to help, you know, rescue the situation. He's also quoted as saying that there have been improvement in the way the police operate, investigations, etc., etc. I've been saying those things too. I've been saying those things to the Minister of Home Affairs at the time. If one was to go back and read all that I've said. So he's not saying anything different. And by the way, I noticed he said he's going to launch the National Drug Strategy Master Plan. I wonder which master plan that is. Is it the one that I left at the Ministry of Home Affairs? Or is it a new one they have crafted since I left within that short period of time? It obviously has to be the one that the task force worked on under Mr. Attlee's stewardship. You know, Mr. Attlee was a former chief of staff of the Defense Force and he head of that task force. So that is something that we have to, because I noticed that he has made the correlation between drugs and crime. Well, that is not something new. That's a phenomenon that is universally accepted. So, this reinventing of initiatives taken by the PPP and which were not completed by the PPP, some of which were not completed by the PPP, you know, I think it's an attempt to deceive and to misinform people that they come with something new, whereas they were not new.
Any other question in the statement?
Going along the same lines as Adam, don't you think that there needs to be, well, you don't, what is the party's take on them getting youth that are disadvantaged and already vulnerable into programs in schools, after school activities? Why do we still have a void of of that going on. We don't have a proper library, either a national library or the outlets in various surrounding areas. We don't, there's nothing for them to do. So they're not kept active at all. What is your proposal for that?
Well,
that you're stopping a crime wave in 10 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years from another generation.
Yeah, I have always been making the point during my 10 years as Minister of Home Affairs that this claim that there's nothing for these young people to do when they come out of school, it has to be seen in a relative context. Every government, including ours, made it its duty to establish and to fund programs that would involve young people. We had the programs by the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture at the Kurukuru College. There was also programs at the what used to be called the Eskimo Boys School in on the Eskimo Coast. There are also programs at the Sophia Institution there as well. And the GDF had programs, the police force had programs. They continue with those programs. The present government is continuing those programs, bringing in these young. In addition to that, the Citizen Security Program 1, which has been succeeded by Citizen Security Program 2, funded by the IDB, had a number of training programs for young people in Regions 4, 5, and 6. For almost 3 years, we trained a number of young people in many areas. In this CSP 2, there are similar training programs funded by the IDB, which is yet to get off the ground, but has been unable to do so because this government has requested certain changes in the program. And once you request changes in the program, you have to go back to the IDB board for consideration and approval. So we have been doing things while we were in the government. And research shows that the things, programs that were taking place. This government is not only continuing with some of those things, but I noticed in Rupert Rupnarain's statement recently, he spoke about trained social workers or probation officers being in each school to deal with crime, violence, truancy, and so forth in the school system. Now, I have also made the point, and I remain committed to this view, that crime is only one aspect of the wider question of interpersonal violence. Crime and criminal activities is only one aspect of this broader question, which has to be seen in the social context. The police alone cannot address all the ramifications of interpersonal violence. It has to be the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Social Protection, or whatever it is called now. It has to be the Ministry of Sports. It has to be all the social ministries, including the Public Security Ministry, the Office of the President, as well as the Ghana Police Force and the law enforcement agencies working together. We had this, what is called the a conference at the International Conference Center some years ago. Out of that came a plan. We hired a consultant to formulate an action recommendation, sorry, I think there were 71 recommendations. We hired a consultant to formulate out of those 71 recommendations an action plan and an implementation plan and how to finance that plan. I understand the matter was recently raised at a meeting with Mr. David Granger and this Gender and Equality Commission or whatever this is called. And I was made to understand he was, a request was made to put that committee back in place, which Ram Jaitan had disbanded, because they now come to the realization that anti-personal violence cannot be addressed only by the Guyana Police Force. It has to be addressed by a number of social NGO, social organizations, government agencies and departments, and faith-based organizations. That's how the COPS and something, and I forgot the exact name of it, came into place, where the pastors would sit with the police at police stations and deal with false offenders, who may have committed some misdemeanor in a community. The COPS and Faith, that's what it's called, COPS and Faith program. We put that in place, and I understand it's working well. And that is a good example to show how the social side of anti-personal violence can be addressed. On the question of domestic violence, we said that in each village, apart from the police presence, apart from community policing, there should be a social worker. Because you would know as journalists, many times when a man hacks to death a woman, when a man slaps a woman or beats a woman, she goes to the police station to report it. It's only after the incident that the neighbors would say, we used to hear this all the time, the man beating the woman, the man doing this and the man doing that. But never ever did they go to report it. They would say, they're not getting in between this husband and wife story, teeth and tongue must bite, and all kind of excuses they're making until the matter becomes a serious crime. And then everybody's told that these two people are fighting all the time. No preventative steps are taken. But the preventative steps can only be taken by either the residents in the community, the social worker who's posted in the community, and the police who's doing some kind of welfare work or whatever in the community itself. So it has to be an integrated process. And in any case, the police don't do like what they used to do before, walk around in the villages, know the neighbors, talk to the villagers and things like that and so forth. They're patrolling on the public roads. And if they go into the villages, it's just a turn around and out. That's why we put so much emphasis on the community policing, because they're there in the community as well as the neighborhood police. So this is a much bigger question than it appears on the surface.
Any other question in the statement? If not, any other question to the GS?
I'm about connecting you. The party was out in the Essica writing last week. Can you give us an update what the meetings were about? You know, after came out, recommendations, some of the concerns that persons in that neighborhood.
But Mr. Mustafa was there, maybe he would be able to give a first-hand report.
This was a normal outreach. We had outreaches in Region 6, Region 5, Region 2. And we had about 47 meetings on the SEQ calls. And the concern were the farmers, them are not getting market for the paddy. And at all these meetings, it was well attended. And a number of issues raised that, for example, that some of the farmers are saying that they cannot able to go back to the land. They are producing a bag of paddy for $2,700 and they're selling it below $2,000. So you could see that they are losing for a bag of paddy. So these were some of the issues that were raised. And if you look at in the news, a 9-point plan have been issued that how the government could ease the burden on the rice farmer. And those were some of the issues raised. But majority of the meeting, all the meetings, the issue of rice, market for the paddy, those are the things that were raised, and also in Region 5 and 6. And the GS had some on the East Coast. He could talk about those, some of those outreaches that he had on the East Coast too, some of those meetings.
Well, I think he wants to remain about the Eskimos.
Can you tell you what the East Coast?
The East Coast meetings were mainly to do with strengthening the party structures on the ground. Now, in relation to the rice issue, I noticed that mention was made about Mexico and so forth.
Portugal, Mexico, and Panama.
Portugal, Mexico, and Panama. But I saw former Minister of Agriculture made reference to the fact that we are already exporting rice to Portugal and Panama. So it's kind of dishonest to say that we're now going to be exporting rice to those two markets. In respect to Mexico, you know, as a former Minister of Foreign Trade, I was doing some research, and the first thing a trade minister looks for when you're talking about market access is the following. The tariffs, what are the trade barriers to imports getting into a market? How high are the tariffs? The question of sanitary and phytosanitary measures. What are the nature of these sanitary and phytosanitary measures? And whether there are any trade preferences with other countries in respect to that particular product. So it's not just glib talk about us getting into a market. We are still doing the research to establish the market accessibility for Guyana's rice into Mexico. So it's okay, you can have a political chat with another person, you know, on the question of market access. But the devil is usually in the details in terms of getting. Look, for example, Trinidad. How difficult it was for one time for us to export rice to Trinidad. At one time they said the grain of the rice was not suitable for their the consumers in their domestic market. Another time they said the color of the rice was not acceptable to the consumers in our market, on their market. Another time they said the scent, the smell of the rice was not acceptable to the consumers in the Trinidad market. And they raised a whole set of issues as well. So much so that it became almost impossible for us to export rice to Trinidad and Tobago. And many of the other countries were importing Uncle Ben's rice from the United States on a much cheaper basis, even though Guyana had the capacity to export, to produce the quantities and to export on a reliable basis, because reliability is also a factor, and cost of transportation as well. So if we're having these challenges here in CARICOM, one can very well imagine what can be the challenges in other extra-regional markets as well. And then again, you have to be able to supply the CARICOM market before you're able to export to a foreign market as well. So these are a number of issues that you have to look at. Sorry, somebody was asking something just now.
I just had a follow-up. Was there a response? I know that Mr. Siraj was the one that had issued the press statement. Has there been a response?
Not yet. Yesterday, last night, we had a chat with Siraj, and he told me that we haven't been in a response. But let us see. Well, we have been making these proposals, as a matter of fact, that some of the proposals were to lower the cost, reduce the duty, and these input for rice. They haven't responded. As a matter of fact, the RPA, whenever the RPA now make a submission or make a proposal, because they haven't recognized the RPA. The RPA was just got 3 persons on the GRDB board. They haven't put those 3 persons on the board. The act, the right acts say that. It had to got 3 persons on the National DNI board. They haven't put the, because the RPA submitted the names and they are not responding. Any other question?
Yes. 2 weeks ago, you said that the party was going to apply pressure to the government to ensure certain things. And you said that the pressure would come in the form of protests by the rice farmers and protests by the sugar workers. Is that still the plan, and if so, how is it going?
Listen to me, this is not a plan. I notice your subtle interjection of this concept. This is not a plan on our part. I never said we had a plan to do this, because I notice in certain quarters, certain individuals who obviously have a political agenda are inferring that the strike, recent strike in the sugar industry, was politically instigated. This is not something you heard it before in the 60s. And even in the 70s and so forth. Anytime Gao decides on its own, without political direction from the PPP, based on consultation with its, what you call them, the field.
General Council.
The General Council and the representatives and so on. And their assessment of the situation. They decide to call a strike. It's always deemed political. Although Gao and the sugar workers don't have an entitlement to strike. But everybody else could strike except Gao and the sugar workers. So I never said that we had a plan. What I said was, looking at the situation as it is evolving politically. When you look at rice, you see the difficulty of the rice. People are going, we didn't plan what happened in rice. We didn't plan the, the cessation of the Petro-Caribbean agreement. That took place as a result of the government actions. And then the rice farmers began to react to it. Now, in respect to the sugar industry, we didn't plan that the government would set up a commission of inquiry, and we didn't plan that it would be privatization or selling out of the factory. We're going back to Matsade. You watch what will happen. We used to say Matsade done. But it looked to me like Matsade not done, because once you sell those sugar plantations and those factories and so on to private people, you're going back to the day of the white man, or this time it could be like Frantz Fanon, black skin, white mask, or a white mask, black skin, walking around the sugar estate, you know, dealing in a particular way with sugar workers. So I want to assure you that this had nothing to do with any plan in the PPP to do these things. But the other point I'd like to make while you raise that question, because y'all would raise issues that I would raise, as you know, so I can piggyback on something you raised now, which is the following. And it's in form of a question. Why is the government paying so much attention to the non-productive sector compared to the productive sector? Productive sector meaning rice farmers, sugar workers, and many others in the productive sector who produce wealth. Wealth that is sold abroad for foreign exchange, and wealth that creates growth in the economy. As a result of which, the non-productive and other in the services sector would benefit. It would seem to me that the priority should be to pay more attention to the productive sectors, so that wealth creation could grow and expand both vertically and horizontally, so that the non-productive sector, who are contributing in terms of management, supervision, this, that, and the other, could benefit. But if you continue this way, it would mean that the productive sector, being treated in the way they're being treated, will obviously be seriously affected, as a result of which the productive sector will not grow, and this will compound the entire situation in the country, economically and so forth. The reaction of the rice farmer, the reaction of the sugar workers, is as a result of the actions taken by the government towards the productive sector. These people produce wealth. These people produce wealth. Why are you treating them like that?
Any other question? If not, thank you all, ladies and gentlemen.
California.